Welcome to Simcha, a celebration of life. I'm your host, Eitan Berger. On the 30th of June this year, the Cape Town Holocaust Centre launched a new exhibit entitled Fighting for the Fatherland, which tells the story of Bernard Schragenheim, a German Jew who fought as part of the German army during World War I. The display comprises rare German artifacts and memorabilia that belonged to Bernard Schragenheim and members of his family. Today, Bernard's son Julian tells us the story of what life was like for German Jews in Germany pre and post World War I.
My late father was born in Berlin, as I was subsequently. He was born in 1891. The Schragenheim family as such came from just south of Hamburg, a village called Pferden an der Aller. The Aller was a little stream flowing into the big river, the Elbe. And they had lived there probably for centuries. But the name Schragenheim is relatively new. It was created, so to say, in 1810, when my forebear, who had the Hebrew name Chaim ben Schrager, was told that he now had the right, if he wished, to become a citizen of the Kingdom of Prussia. But they said to him, not with your Hebrew name, you have got to have a more German-sounding name. So he switched Chaim ben Schrager around and made Schragenheim of it. And he was already then a man of 65 with six sons. And they all became Schragenheims, so to speak, overnight.
The significance of the exhibition that's behind me, Fighting for the Fatherland, is that when the center was established, the permanent exhibition opened with stories about Jews arriving in South Africa. Now, because of the history of Jews in South Africa coming from Eastern Europe, there was a gap in the exhibition in terms of the story of Jews coming from Germany and their experiences, those who arrived and also those who were left behind. So it's a really beautiful story because it also depicts the experience of Jews living in Germany and how they had to negotiate the changes that took place with the rise of Nazism. For example, those Jews who had fought during the First World War, such as Bernard Schragenheim, were no longer considered to even be German. So how did they deal with that? And the exhibition aims to explore that.
When the war broke out, my father was called up immediately, and when he was considered to be trained sufficiently and was sent to the front in Russia.
Understanding the story of the Schragenheims provides you, it's not representative of all of German Jewry, but I think what it does provide us with is a taste of the atmosphere of what life was like. And what that is that it was inclusive. Jews living in Germany were German. They were patriotic, they were involved, they were engaged in the intellectual and philosophical discourse at the time, which was quite significant. And I think the number of Jews who received awards after World War I demonstrates that as well. And of course, you also have an active Jewish life in Germany that you see, and the Schragenheim family was quite involved in that. So there's pockets of sort of advanced, integrated, almost assimilated Jewry, but you still have that experience of this sort of semi-rural, peri-urban Jew living in sort of in villages as well in Germany.
My father started his active service career in the machine gun company of Reserve Regiment number 48, which was part of the 5th Reserve Division of the Imperial German Army. And he started by walking about 30 kilometers daily with a box of ammunition on his chest and a box of ammunition on his back. So by 1916, he was still in Russia and he'd reached the rank of sergeant. Now, on the 15th of July, 1916, in the middle of what was known, or what is known to historians today, as the Brusilov Offensive, my father, with the only machine gun left in the group to which he belonged, at the joining point between the German armies in the north and the Austro-Hungarian armies in the south, at the point where they joined, sat my father with the only machine gun that had not been destroyed by very accurate Russian artillery fire. Now, my father managed to keep going with that one machine gun, and it is my view that without realizing it, I think he saved the whole of the Austrian front from total collapse, which would have had the greatest military and political implications. He got the Iron Cross Second Class. It's quite interesting that when the war was over, for about a week or two, he was given out of a clear blue sky, he got the Iron Cross First Class awarded to him. He said to me in later years, he never quite knew for what. My own belief is that they reviewed their own performance, the performance of the regiment during the whole of the war, and they decided Schragenheim is still alive and with us. Maybe he should have had more than the Iron Cross Second Class.
The universality of Bernard's experience, despite its historical specificity, provides a striking educational tool which demonstrates how radical discrimination is an agent that leads to both the loss of personal and group identity.
The conscription of German men for the First World War meant that Jewish men, you know, in Germany were obliged to join the armed forces. I think then the question that arises, and especially one that arises quite often in our exhibition and in tours that we have, school learners that come, we often ask the question, if there is such a thing as conscription in a society, can you argue that a person who served in the army was patriotic? And does that demonstrate their patriotic duty? It's debatable, because if they're obliged to fight, does that necessarily say anything about how strongly they feel? I think the difference is when you see how many fought bravely, how many received Iron Crosses. I think that's quite strong. That really demonstrates how, first of all, how much of a military focus there was as a part of German identity, how, you know, a stronger part of the culture it was to be able to say that Germany had a strong army, a strong armed forces. And I think that's also why in the defeat after World War I, it was such a strong blow to German, German pride, generally speaking.
As far as the duty which they performed in the First World War was concerned, it was their duty, they had to do it. It was normal and natural, in the same way in which I thought it was my duty to serve in General Smuts's army in the Second World War. And once one feels it's your duty, then you do it. You don't argue about it any further, you do it. And that was a situation with my father. He was, and with my two uncles, they were German citizens. Their duty in the army was the same as paying their taxes. They had to do it because they were citizens, and that was it, for better or for worse.
35,000 Jewish soldiers received awards for bravery and service during the First World War, and 100,000 served. I mean, that, you know, so it indicates how involved and how engaged they were and how much a part of German society the Jewish community was. They were so integrated, and all the more the tragedy of almost overnight, life changing so drastically. In fact, in one of the interviews, I remember Julian sharing with me how, you know, his father's experience of losing the, not just the medals themselves. I mean, obviously the medal doesn't mean much if it isn't official. It's that recognition that was undermined. Bernhard Schragenheim was fighting in the same trenches as Adolf Hitler. And we see how much changed with the rise of Nazism, that suddenly Bernhard Schragenheim would no longer have been regarded as a German. Never mind, he would no longer have been regarded as a human being. That's how, you know, virulent the anti-Semitism was of Nazism. So it's extremely strange and extremely unusual and surprising in the kind of culture that we live in, where the Holocaust and the experience and the history of Nazism is what you think about, or what comes to mind when you think about Germans during the wars, the world wars, in the first half of the 20th century. So I think that's why this is such a unique and successful installation, and why the Schragenheim collection is so powerful, is because it gives you not only the military and the official aspects of this, you know, this Jewish community, but also the very personal and emotional and psychological implications of losing your identity. What it meant to be German was not in violation of being Jewish.
We arrived in South Africa, I can give you the exact date. We arrived on the 17th of May, 1934. And now, my late father was fortunate. He'd had a thin time economically during the previous number of years. But in South Africa, you might say he fell on his feet. He was the first, I think, to bring modern decorative electric light fittings to South Africa on a wholesale basis. And he did sufficiently well from the beginning to be able to concern himself with bringing other family members to South Africa. The South African government of that time, General Herzog and General J.C. Smuts, passed an Aliens Act in 1937, which declared people like me as unassimilable. So it became immensely difficult for German Jews to come to South Africa. I think the number that actually arrived here was about 2,000 men, women, and children. And what he succeeded in doing with his in-laws, he did not succeed in doing with his father and his mother and his young sister. Well, at that stage, of course, she wasn't so young anymore, unmarried. She looked after the old people. And fortunately, under the circumstances, they died in their own beds. Probably starvation had something to do with it. Taking into account that Jews did not get ration cards, my aunt succeeded in keeping them alive, my grandfather until 1940, my grandmother until 1941. Then they both died a quiet death. And when she realized that they were coming to get her in Berlin in November 1942, my aunt, who was doing some social work in what was left of the Jewish community, knew about it and took her own life before they could come and get her.
In all, it took about 2.5 years of interviews, of this sort of very patient, ongoing process of coffees and lunches and conversations. And in the process as well, he actually, the two of us started presenting. So we would present to various groups. We presented at Highlands House to his peers. We spoke to a number of Jewish community organizations, Limud. And I think that was really wonderful. It gave him a lot of confidence that what he had chosen to do, to hand over this collection, was the right choice. And it also meant that he gained trust. And that's when he really started giving us all the really meaty material. So I would argue that the most powerful material in the collection are his father's war diaries. They are in three journals. Two leather-bound and one written in pencil, which go from 1915 until December 1918, and really give you a sense of what it was like psychologically to be a soldier in the trenches.
The Schragenheim story is told through memories, photos, and letters, which have brought to light the exceptional vulnerability of Jews in wartime Germany. This display explores the complexity of cultural and national identity through the telling of the Schragenheim's family story.
His letters and postcards mainly date back to the First World War. I think the Germans at that time began to understand a security angle only later during that war. So he sent back to my aunt, who was a schoolgirl at that time, the postcards that my late father sent back had frontline illustrations, frontline photographs on the one side and writing on the other side. And when my father realized, I would say in 1970 or 1918, that he couldn't write anything sensible in a postcard anymore without having it censored, he kept a diary.
The diary was in, obviously in German and in really, really difficult script. An intern that was here from Germany had actually studied translation. We were very lucky, and she translated the bulk of it. She transcribed and translated it. Unfortunately, the final diary was just too hard to read. It was in this very pale pencil, and it also gives you an indication of, you know, handwriting in the trenches. How much time and energy do you have? At the beginning, he writes a lot about life and, you know, general musings about what he's going to do when he finishes his service. By the end of the war, it's two lines where he's talking about what he ate, what card game he played, whether he slept, where he slept. You know, it really shows the experience of suffering that one went through as a soldier in the First World War, the forgotten war, this notion of men fighting, you know, face to face, as opposed to behind a machine, behind a tank. So I think that's really quite an experience, especially now that we're commemorating 100 years since the war began. And in fact, once when he finally handed over all of them and we really had gotten to speaking about what happened to his aunt in the end, her sad story, he said to me once that his aunt had paid with her life for this material to still exist. She had sent it off and somehow collated a lot of the material, the postcards as well as other letters and documents, and that's how we have it. So, you know, the collection is more than just a bunch of papers that are historically interesting. Emotionally, they bring back to life the family that he lost. One of the entries that that came sort of in the last days of the war, sort of the first week of November 1918, Bernard writes about where they're going to sleep that night, how he lost three men that day, and how he wasn't feeling well. And then, you know, of course, they found a rest place, but then they were told that they had to march on. So getting used to that life must have been unbearable. And the fact that he came home with a couple of hundred men having risen through the ranks and was able to be able to say that he was, you know, a commander of within this Regiment 48, that's what earned him his Iron Crosses, you know. So it's a different world, and it's so removed from what we understand and how we understand warfare today.
It gave me a tremendous feeling of satisfaction that I never had before in my life, to think that they and I could be instrumental in doing justice to people long dead. I thought of my late father, and I thought specifically of my aunt. Although it would have been very difficult in any case to get them out of Germany. But I can say without exaggeration, my aunt sacrificed herself for her old parents. And the idea that I am helping to give her some mention among the general public, considering what she did, that makes me feel very happy and satisfied.
I think it afforded him the opportunity to go back in his mind to places, to people that he otherwise thought were long gone. What was really emotional, and actually is quite still emotional if I think about it, there was one letter that was translated from his grandmother, Julian Schragenheim, who passed away in Berlin. And it was a letter written in Old German wishing him Mazel Tov for his bar mitzvah. And he was quite emotional, as we all were. It was so profound. And as he said, it was as if our whole process had brought her personality back to life for him. And I think that's been the most rewarding aspect of it for me, is being able to give him something personal, you know, in return for this priceless collection that he's donated to our museum.
Sadly, that's all we have time for this week's episode of Simcha. As always, it's been a pleasure to have you join us. We love hearing from you, so please find us on Facebook at Spirit Sister Productions and drop us a line. From myself, Eitan Berger, and all of us here at Simcha, have a great week and goodbye.